Hello and welcome to Lärarpodden, a podcast from the Swedish National Union of Teachers. Today we are at a Swedish book fair in Gothenburg, and I have three prominent guests here: Sharon Burrow, Åsa Fahlén, and Kristina Henschen. So you're so welcome to be here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
First, a short presentation of you. We will talk today about the role of unions in Sweden and internationally. But our listeners might not know who you are, so let's tell them. Sharon Burrow, you are from Australia.
I am.
You've been traveling far?
No, I am Australian. I live in Brussels because that's the headquarters of the International Trade Union Confederation. And we have as affiliates all of the national centres of countries. So those unions in Sweden who belong to their national centres, they belong to us as members, 180 million members all around the world.
Well, that's a lot. And you are the General Secretary.
I am.
Yes. And before that, you were the President.
I was.
And you are the first woman who have had these roles.
Yeah.
That's very nice.
And she is a previous teacher, we have to add.
Yes.
That's true. In fact, the Teachers Union internationally, Education International, when I was head of my own union in Australia, the Australian Education Union, I was a vice president of the Education International, and it was in fact formed. It merged two major organisations and brought some other independent groups in Stockholm in 1993, I believe, if I get my history right, and I was there.
Oh.
It was freezing, but the wall came down and we were one global united educational union. And now, of course, in my new role, I work with Fred Van Leeuwen and David Edwards and Angelo Gavrilatis and all the other colleagues in the Education International quite closely.
Well, that's nice. So I'm sure you can give us some very interesting perspectives on union work and teaching, the teaching profession, later on in this program. And also we have Kristina Henschen. You are the director of Union to Union in Sweden. Can you tell us a bit about Union
yes,
to Union?
Yes, with pleasure. Union to Union is not well known, unfortunately, in Sweden. It's probably more known outside of Sweden, because what we do, we are the Swedish trade union solidarity organization. For the Swedish trade union, we work and provide support from SIDA through the Swedish Union to more than 90 countries worldwide. We are a unique confederation with our members are LO, TCO, and our newest member is SACO, the family where the Teachers Union of Sweden is part and affiliated. So we are very happy to have you as our newest member.
Mm. We are happy to be members.
Yes.
And here we have Åsa Fahlén. You are our chairperson. I don't want to say chairman. It feels wrong.
President.
Yeah, president. of the National Union of Teachers in Sweden, Lärarnas Riksförbund, since last year.
Last year, end of May.
Yes.
And before that, I was a teacher. I taught civics and history.
Yes. For how long have you been a teacher?
Almost 20 years in upper secondary school.
Yes. It's a fantastic occupation to have.
It is. And sometimes I miss it. you miss the students.
Yeah.
I used to teach secondary schools and indeed history. So there you go.
Yeah.
Yes. Do you miss your students as well?
Yes. I always thought teaching would be my last job, but my friends tell me that it's now very difficult, very, very difficult profession. I wouldn't have the skills for it anymore. And maybe they're right.
Yeah. But for how long was it since you...
I taught for about 12 years.
Yeah.
And then my union one day asked me to do an organizer's job for teachers, other teachers. And I stepped out just to do that, and the rest is history.
Yeah.
I never meant not to be a teacher. It indeed gave me, I think, much of the foundation skills I have today to do my job. Mm-hmm. And I loved it.
Mm. Yes.
And just like you said, that you never intended to do something else, but you wanted to improve the conditions for the job that you loved.
Exactly.
Many of us have a similar story. I never meant to leave teaching, but I wanted to improve the conditions. And I think that's perhaps the basis of this conversation. Why do we have unions?
Yes.
Why is it important to be part of a union?
Yes, that's exactly what I want to talk about today, because it is so different around the world, the situation of people working and the situation of teachers. Maybe we can start with the teachers. I mean, we have a lot of things we complain about here in Sweden we're not happy with, but I know the situation in other countries are much different, and they have other things they fight for. What do you say? What is it like to be a teacher in, what should we say, China? Or?
Well, I have to say that I think the dominant pedagogy would astound you. Teachers are teachers all over the world. And, you know, when you interact with students, when you're passing on knowledge, when you're helping them develop their own knowledge base, there's a toolkit that teachers use. But it has a lot of the same elements, irrespective of the cultural differences or the, you know, the nature of the content in front of you. So knowledge is knowledge, teachers are teachers, and students are there to learn. And it's an extraordinary profession to see the commonality. But does that bring solidarity? You know, both when I did work as a leader of the teachers' union, as a teacher indeed, and now, wherever you go, teachers have extraordinary values. They're incredibly committed to the future for their students, and they're more likely to be fighting for class sizes or inclusion or the elimination of fees or resources for education than they are for themselves. They're incredible human beings, and I'm proud to have been part of that profession.
Mm. I think part of being a teacher is to fight for all students or children's possibilities in society, and I think that might be a difference in depending on the extent of the democracy in a country, because in a democratic country it's easier to actually fight for those rights for each student. In a totalitarian society, I believe it's harder, because all organizations, knowledge and those things are seen as dangerous to a totalitarian regime.
Well, and particularly the exclusion of young girls and women from education. There are teachers around the world who are incredibly courageous. They will, in that case, put their own lives potentially on the risk to educate girls. There are teachers who will stand up in times of conflict and try to continue to educate people despite the military or terrorism activity around them. And everywhere you go, when you see disaster, teachers are there. They're part of the community. They pick up the pieces and they try to centralise the educational opportunities for students as the heart of development. And that's, I think, a critical part of who we are as human beings, of our very civilization, and, of course, that means of our democratic strengths.
And I would like to add to that that there are also other factors influencing those opportunities or access to education, of course, such as the fact that very few girls and women have access to hygiene products when they menstruate. That leads to an enormous loss of girls and young women in the educational system all over the world. Because they don't have access to safe and private toilets, they don't have access to tampons or sanitary pads, and that leads them to staying at home and therefore they also discriminated heavily. This is upcoming as a quite an important factor of gender equality in many of the trade unions that we see all over the world. And also I would like to add that it's fantastic that education has finally become acknowledged as one of the main factors for sustainable development in the world, since it's now goal number 4 of the new global goals, which is called, they're called Agenda 2030, the access to quality education. So of course, education is so important for our future, and the teachers have a key role to play here.
And nobody fought harder to get education as a standalone goal than the teachers' unions around the world, led by Education International. We backed them in, but they were the fighters to say, this is at the heart of what sustainability and that pathway that the goals promise us. If you take the 17 goals and the Paris Climate Agreement, for the trade unions, we say it offers the promise of a zero poverty, zero carbon world. And to have education recognised as one of those 17 goals is absolutely essential. In fact, 16, because goal 17 is partnership. And nobody's better than community alliances and partnership than teachers and their unions.
Mm. You said you backed them up. How? I don't know so much about this, and perhaps not our listeners do that either. How do you work when you back them up? How does it work, this international work that you do that is so important? That
Well, all of our members are the national centres like ELO, TCO, SACO, etc. But the industrial unions who are members of those affiliates also are organised internationally in their trade or occupation or industry structures. And so I have a group of colleagues who were, while I head up the peak for the trade union centres, who are secretaries and presidents of those industry sectors. And we work together in a trade union senate, and I'm their secretary as well in the Council of Trade Unions. So if you've got the teachers or the transport workers or the agricultural workers or the public sector workers, and they're engaged in a dispute or a struggle or a campaign for improvement, then we support them.
Mm. And how would you say your biggest possibilities to change things? You have possibilities to change things, and you have struggles that you are fighting for. What are your main issues right now?
Well, for the ITUC, we have 3 main front lines, and they are eliminating slavery, and teachers have been critical in that fight, while we focused on forced labour predominantly in partnership with and led by Education International, the teachers' unions. They've fought on child labour. And so for most children in child labour, about 150 million children around the world, they're either not in school or they're not adequately able to focus on their studies. That's a huge fight for teachers. Our fight for climate justice, for climate action, and a just transition for all workers and their communities, which we were successful in getting into the Paris Agreement, along with a commitment to human rights. The teachers were part of that fight through their own national unions and indeed internationally. And of course, we now have a huge fight on our hands around inequality. And part of that for us is actually seeing fair wages and rights and decent work, because our global workforce is in deep trouble. It's predominantly a low-paid, insecure or precarious and often unsafe workforce with few rights. Social protection doesn't exist for about 75% of the world's people. These are struggles that teachers take up just like other trade unionists. And so when we're fighting the corporate greed of the current model, if you think that companies pay tax or evade tax, if we can fight to end the corruption of tax evasion, there's more money in government budgets and there's more capacity then to fund education, which is a huge fight for the teachers' unions right now. So in that context, you know, these struggles are aligned. And again, I just come back to the fact that teachers share strong commitments to democratic values, and we'd want them to, because we want them to pass those values of freedom and rights and humanity onto our children, so they too will be able to fight for their own democracies and build their own futures.
Mm. And your work, Christina, internationally, you have lots of contacts around. How do you tackle this? What are your struggles right now?
So we have so many important projects. A very important part of the portfolio of 90 countries and 100 projects is, of course, with the educational system. What we see all over the world is, of course, what Sharon Burrow is mentioning, the fact that 58 million children do not have access to education, and that they are in slavery instead. But also other problems like para-teachers, or that the status of the teachers are going down all over the world, and the payment is going down as well. Moreover, the fact that private actors are taking over big parts of the educational systems in whole countries is of course a challenge, like in Liberia, where the full educational basic educational system was sold out to private actors. So there are so many important areas where we support an improvement.
And the intimidation of that. I actually met the teacher union in Kenya just about a month ago, who stood up against Bridge Academies, who'd bought education systems from the government, or handed it actually. They're taking profit off the top. They're charging students fees. In fact, in many areas, they're forcing students into child labour because the parents can't afford the fees. So to stay in the schools, the students are out actually working in the morning, trying to sell products on the streets or in other areas in order to make money for their school fees. So it really does say that unless we as a society are prepared to fund education, that it is so important for everybody that everyone gets an equal opportunity, then we're really perpetuating a society where difference is and inequality is the obvious outcome. But Union to Union supports work that goes beyond that. They support our human and trade union rights program. And right now we have teachers in jail in Iran and other places. And that helps the whole of the trade union movement actually defend those actors. And something that's worrying us all very much, and I know from having been a teacher and a teacher leader, you know, we drove a lot of the peace education programs during the Cold War, and it's how old I am now, and, you know, beyond, in the time of the, the wars in the Balkans. There were schools being established and by teachers even in the heart of the conflict. So Union to Union, I'm not sure this is public knowledge yet, but is going to fund a very different approach to talking about how we've undone conflict situations in the past, how we've rebuilt democracy, and what we have to do as trade unionists in the future. And it will be a conversation, an intergenerational conversation in a peace summit between current leaders, older leaders like myself, and young leaders, intergenerational. And I know this will be very dear to the teacher's heart. So this organisation, the Swedish Union to Union, which is in itself a partnership, so Goal 17, is actually very important to the work of trade unions all over the world.
Mm.
Thank you. We are trying to do our best, but the context is so challenging today. What we see all over the world is that the work of trade union leaders and the trade unions are being harshly attacked all over the world. And as the ITUC has an index measuring this, it's horrendous what is actually going on, where the amount of countries where people are being killed for their trade union activities are increasing. The amount of countries where union activists are subject to violence are increasing. So we are together trying to form those partnerships, those alliances, and turn this repressive wave around. And that's for, I'm very happy to welcome also the National Union of Teachers of Sweden into this cooperation, because the more we are, the stronger we are, of course. And I would like to add that we also have quite interesting opportunities in terms of our material for teachers in Swedish, where you can order as a teacher from our website and use them in your education about the global trade union work and the global situation for workers. And we would be so happy to be contacted and to help out. And we can also offer lecturing on those issues and other forms of cooperation. So please feel free to contact. This is my message to teachers that are out there, to contact us, and we will do our best to support teachers.
Well, that's a good thing to know. It's union2union.org.
Yes.
Yes, and that's where you can find it. Also, I'm thinking, when you tell us about people fighting for their rights with the risk of being killed, I think in Sweden, are we a bit spoiled here? Some people don't really appreciate what we have. What do you say?
Yes, I think you're right to some extent, both when it comes to grown-ups, but also when it comes to young people today. You take for granted, and that's dangerous, because democracy and human rights are nothing that's always exists. You have to exist. You have to work with it. You have to work for it. So the material that you mention, if that can help the teachers to broaden the views for the students, to actually to push on certain things and say that you have to be an active citizen, you have to stand up and say no to the things that you think are wrong, you have to work for the things that you think are important, you have to take sides, you have to be active in the debate. So don't take it for granted. And I think that's like union to union, you can show that, because I think even though we have come further in a way, we have it's free to organize yourself in Sweden. It's not I'm not threatened to be thrown in jail because I'm a teacher, but we also fight with inequalities. We see that the Swedish school system becomes more and more unequal, and I think in the long run that threatens our society. So to be aware of that, everybody, depending on where you are, but everybody has to work actively to keep the democracy and to improve it, to make it live longer.
And the Swedish model stands tall in the world, and it's worth fighting for.
It is.
If we lose the model of democracy, where people care about each other, you share your wealth, you're prepared to pay for collective services, you educate your children, you know, then, and you look after the vulnerable. If these things are lost here, then God help us, because that's what we want to build everywhere. And I was telling a group earlier today that, you know, Swedish people are great internationalists. You have union to union, of course, so that's all of the union members and their federation saying we're going to stand in solidarity with other nations and other struggles. But, you know, your Prime Minister's launched an initiative that we're 100% behind. It's called the Global Deal. And what it asks people to do is talk to each other, to put up examples of good dialogue where that solve problems, whether it's in our schools or our workplaces or in communities. When people actually talk to each other, find out what they have in common and settle their differences in the interests of strengthening our communities and our democracies. And so, you know, that outreach from Swedish people based on their own stability and solidarity as a nation, you know, rich in a difficult sometimes but democratic tradition, that's really important.
Yes. That's something to remember. And I think we have unfortunately run out of time. So these will be the final words here. I will thank. Or do you have something you want to add before we? Before we.
No, I'm so grateful that we can cooperate in this way with the National Union of Sweden, together with the other teachers' union, and that we are forming our alliances through this for a better world. So thank you so much.
And we are so happy to be part of Union to Union. And this solidarity work internationally is very important. So we hope to have a good cooperation.
And I'd just say, remember every day to thank a teacher. If you can read, thank a teacher. If you can actually engage with people, get the skills you need for your future work, thank a teacher.
Thank you for saying that to all our listeners. I think they want to hear that. And so thank you, Sharon, Christina, and Åsa for today. It was very nice to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Thank you.